hope that by the point, everything that you hear that's redundant from this point on, you believe you should do. If it's something you keep hearing, and diabetes comes to mind, you should know that. And so, but you know, you've heard about genes for so long, maybe you should really get them if you don't yet, you know, because how you put up, you reject things. It's just the things you keep hearing, you might as well just dive into. So we know human genome, really all the genetic material in DNA, 23 pairs of chromosomes. One set came from mama, one set came from daddy. No matter what you believe about any of it, that's the way that actually works. And so there's a male and a female set, so you have 23 pairs. Variation between us is 0.1%. We share 99.99 is similar. And so our nearest relative is the chimp, and there's only 4% difference between the chimpanzee and us, which I just think is so fascinating and lovely, isn't it, though? Because they have 24 pairs of chromosomes. That's why you can't mate with them. There's other reasons. but that's one of them. Remember diploid and haploid? Are those words you hate a little bit? I don't know. I feel like people kind of hate haploid and diploid sometimes, but I love it. So it just means that, you know, you had 23 pairs of chromosomes. That's diploid. And so N is a single full set of genetic material. 2N is two sets of genetic material, and all of our cells have two sets. Where did they come from? The fact that there was fertilization between two asymmetrical gametes. And so N plus N made 2N. Aw, you're 2N. You're so cute. You're diploid. And so there's all the cells are going to be diploid. There'll be a set of cells that are specialized for gamete production, and they will be haploid, because if a diploid matched with a diploid, you'd have a tetraploid, and you see that pretty soon we'd have to be massive so our cells could hold all that DNA. So the gametes are one set of chromosomes, and they're made through specialized cell division called meiosis, which you recall. And all the other cells of the body, somatic cells, are diploid, and they come from cell division called mitosis, which you've also recalled. I'm going to repeat quickly. Composition of the genome. It's really weird that there's only about like 25,000 coding genes. And a coding gene would be a gene that's expressed that makes a protein. And so that's the only difference between us and chimps or dinosaurs or ferns is really what proteins we're producing. Because that protein goes to how that cell looks and acts. The proteins are making the cell look a certain way, be able to live a certain way, interact with the cell next to it in a certain way. It produces proteins for its job, and that makes that whole body then become what it is, just based on the recipe of genes and the proteins that they were produced. So we know it's pretty complicated. So there's a lot of other DNA there that really just kind of helps it all function well. And so a couple of percent of the genome is coding. We have a couple of meters of DNA. The non-coding regions are all kinds of things. It used to be called junk DNA. I don't know if you remember, if you've ever heard this, but you know, like the people who taught me about DNA were not taught about DNA. Which is so weird. I mean, that's how new it is. And now there are like billboards with a sperm on it saying, "Here's your daddy." And we but you know, DNA was really elucidated in the 50s. And so the professors that taught me, their professors did not teach them about DNA. So anyway, pretty cool. So they would say things like junk DNA. 98% of your DNA is junk. Well, really, it isn't. You're not junk. You're not junk. But there's a lot of information in there that's not coding. So introns, so within a gene, you've probably talked a lot about introns. Exons are the things we keep. Introns are the things that get processed out. And so there's post-transcriptional processing to remove introns or intervening sequences in the DNA. Those are non-coding. There's intergenic DNA, so DNA between genes, and those are probably promoter regions and things that help regulate transcription of the DNA, so things between genes. And then there's functional RNA, which is various flavors of RNA, and you know these, the functional RNA. So like ribosomal RNA, which combines with ribosomal proteins to form a ribosome, which functions during translation. Transfer RNA, which transfer RNAs compile with, they fold back on themselves and they carry amino acids and they recognize the gene code, the genetic code, and they're transferring amino acids in during translation. The, maybe I have it on the next slide, you want to keep going. Then there are a couple of other little things that you'll hear about if you're reading the literature at all, and you will get bits of this through CME as well sometimes. But this PeeWee interacting RNA is RNA that complexes with PeeWee proteins and functions to silence messenger RNA, so it's translational silencing of protein manufacture, and that's especially important during embryonic development. So yeah, think about that. You know, you have these genes that are on and being transcribed, translated for making proteins now, but that was a whole different set when you're organizing yourself from an unfertilized egg to this trillions of body cells. So you had to have phases where certain parts of the genome were active, and so we had to silence genes at times, even if they get transcribed, and PeeWee RNA is for that. So really, I'll make a sentence that's easy. PeeWee RNA is a functional RNA that was important during translational control. And true with microRNA, these are really small segments of RNA themselves that can just adhere in a complementary way to messenger RNA and serve for post-translational control of messenger RNA as well. So RNA gets the assist. It's rebounding, you know, it's keeping the ball in play. And so a DNA is the point guard and RNA gets the assist. It's really helping that process of making proteins. And so it comes in a lot of flavors. We call those functional RNAs, but they're really non-coding regions. While they're essential to the function, they aren't making a protein itself. I should have had messenger RNA on that list then. That's a real important RNA. I don't have that there. Messenger RNA is another functional RNA. It's the transcript that's produced during transcription and is read during translation and helps to form the gene expression product, which is the protein. You guys remembering all of those parts, all those T's? I'll do this because I like things. I mean, you know, I've been around a long time, but I don't know. I'm sort of average smart, right? So I have a lot of ways to help me. So let me just keep it real clean. This is what I really like to do. This is so insultingly easy. So if we make a copy of DNA from DNA, that process is replication. And honest to God, you just know these things. You keep things so clean you can answer test questions because you can just start ruling out stuff and the wrong words are there. Transcription. Vestigial kind of things, no longer evolutionarily important. Cis and trans segments would be the portions of DNA that can kind of be adherent to complementary sections of DNA and just help with regulation of transcription, repeat sequences. We just have a lot of DNA which is repetitive and which may just serve to help bulk the DNA and decrease deletional or deleterious mutations. Yeah. Viral elements and transposons. Like DNA viruses can just leap into, they can mesh into, like fat fat droplets can coalesce, viral DNA can coalesce and mesh into genomic DNA. And I always forget this number because it's so astonishing, so let me look it up. I think it's 6%. 8%, over 8% of the genome is transposons or viral segments. It's more than we actually use to code. And so that sounds terrifying, but it's actually a way that you acquire new DNA. You know, we interact, we're sexual creatures, so for all organisms that engage in sexual reproduction, we're making new combinations, new genetic combinations all the time to try out new stuff. Prokaryotic organisms or things that are asexual can take on DNA from the exterior and try new combinations. And so we're still doing that, so that's just kind of interesting. There are telomeres, or at the end of segments of DNA, there are repetitive sequences as well. So this is all non-coding, and it accumulates, or it all adds up to really the genome. Mitochondrial DNA is really part of the genome, and there are 37 genes that mitochondria make their own proteins right in there, and that's kind of handy because it's a double membrane thing, so it's a little complicated. But you know, you hear about mitochondrial DNA in all the forensic shows. That's really an interesting way of looking at things, but it's not as specific as genomic DNA or nuclear DNA, because it's only from the maternal source. So you know, you have that great big fat egg and then the little streamlined sperm. All the sperm is in humans, all the sperm is committing to the new individual is DNA only, not even any protein, just DNA. So all of the start of that first egg, or that first fertilized egg, everything there is maternal. So all of the guts of that first cell came from mom. So all of her mitochondria, all of her everything, all the organelles, endoplasmic reticulum, and all that stuff is maternal in descent. So that's the way we work that out. So that's where your mitochondrial DNA comes from. The organization of DNA, you remember the word chromatin. DNA, we don't ever have just DNA in our cells. It's really very complex with proteins, and therefore we call it chromatin. Chromatin is active DNA. It is highly organized and coiled, but it's loose enough that transcription can occur. So when you look at a cell in interphase, those cells, unless you can see DNA in the form of a chromosome, we would say that DNA is in the form of chromatin. Active DNA is in the form of chromatin. So chromatin is DNA plus all of its associated proteins actively engaged in transcription, not potentially replication. So it's DNA at work, chromatin. It's only when you can see the chromosome, even through light microscopy, so it's highly packed, we call it a chromosome. So, you know, we talk about chromosomes in cells, but it's really always in the form of chromatin, unless it's an active cell division. And so you see this lovely DNA helix, and then it gets folded into, remember, the nucleosomes and all of that folding, and then the twisting and the twisting. And it's still very complex together and organized, but active. I think I've said that now 4 times. Let's move on. Chromosomes, then, that's what we tend to call DNA, but DNA in the form of a chromosome is so highly packed that you can't use it. So this is like the plates in your house. The plates are in your cabinet. They're organized, but you can get to them and you can use them. So that's chromatin. When you pack that and you box it up to move, those are chromosomes. You can't really use your plates so well. Now, there will always be a little low-level transcription occurring, potentially, even when a chromosome is so highly folded. But it's for the purposes of packing and moving. And mitosis is a very small segment of the life of that cell. And so we call a segment of that chromosome a chromatid. That's a word that bothers people because, because this is a, where's this? This is a chromatid. So when we kind of look at it, this, you know, there's this sort of centralized location here. So this is a chromatid, like a little propeller. This is a whole chromosome. That would just be like one chromatid of a chromosome. This is a chromosome where you have a replicated form, and that's a chromatid. So these are both chromosomes, and that bugs you, or it used to, until you stopped letting it bother you. So chromosomes are like this, and we have 23 pairs of them. When we undergo replication, we have this. We have 23 pairs of replicated chromosomes. So a replicated chromosome has sister chromatids. It's just a copy that it's attached to, and a centromere is kind of this little location that is sort of centralized-ish. Centromere meaning kind of central body. And it would be the site that spindle fibers attach to for the purpose of moving chromosomes, chromatids, from one pole to the other during cell replication.
So in the drawing on the right, that's two chromatids.
Yes. And it's still a chromosome. I think that's bothersome, though, right? Because there's this time in meiosis where sister chromatids don't separate, and that, you know, that's one of those, I don't know. So anyway, chromatids then are the replicated chromosome partners. If that's a helpful definition, it might not. That was probably like a BS definition, like very political or something. I'm obsessed with politics right now. Obsessed. I'm just trying to figure things out, and so I'm obsessed. And the blessing of our administration to me is I have never learned more. I know more now than about things I never thought about because it's in discussion. I think this is just a great learning period. Chromosomes are visible during cell division, and so we can divide chromosomes into two groups, the autosomes, which are everything but the sex chromosomes. And a karyotype is this way of aligning all the chromosomes. And so in this case, you see replicated chromosomes because they have the sister chromatids. And then they are paired, maternal and paternal pair. Now, we can't determine what came from who, which came from where, because that's no longer important. It doesn't matter if it's maternal source or paternal source. Now we just let go. What's the stronger gene? Use that one. But you have two pairs, so there's 23 pairs of chromosomes, and then that last set are the sex chromosomes, an X and a Y, so-called, because they look that way. And then here's a, I guess this is liver, probably, I don't remember the source, but you can see these cells, all the cells that you can see a nucleus in, then we call that chromatin. And then there are some cells you can see are in the process of dividing. I see a metaphase kind of stands out to me there. There's a prophase or two. When you can see visibly the DNA, then we call those chromosomes. Gosh, I love every single part of biology. DNA gives me chills. DNA gives me straight up nerd chills. And so we're talking about genetics, and you're in PA school, so what's the important part about genetics in PA school is that we do have chromosome disorders. What is this thing? This thing. And so some of chromosome disorders that are of importance occur during non-disjunction. Excuse me, I didn't bring my Hello Kitty cap. Non-disjunction, which means things don't go apart like they're supposed to. Improper junction is a way of saying non-disjunction. Poor junction. And those kind of failures are really happening during the specialized cell division that makes gametes. So it was a kind of failed gamete, something went wrong in processing that gamete. It can happen at two different places. We'll review mitosis here in a minute. Excuse me. Do you want to clear your throat for me when someone does that?
My mama used to do that. She'd get talking like that.
You'd just be going, Girl, you need to expectorate or something. And I'd be talking to her. So normal meiosis, you know, these meiosis one tetrads form. We'll get there if this is cloudy, don't worry about it. The tetrads form homologous pairs of chromosomes, and there's crossover, and then you separate those during meiosis one, and something can go wrong. Or you separate sister chromatids during meiosis two, and something can go wrong. So a failure of separation is called non-disjunction, and there are certain genetic disorders that aren't completely fatal. Any sort of non-disjunction that's inconsistent with life, those are spontaneous abortions. Or those are pregnancies no one ever knew about because they were fatal. But the ones that make it are a few certain diseases. And just showing you, this is not a list I want you to remember things from necessarily unless I specifically mention them. But I'm just showing you there are a lot of diseases that just result as a failure of chromosome distribution during meiosis. And so I'll look at a few of them specifically. And I know I don't really talk about diseases as part of physiology, but it's appropriate, I think, during genetics to say, look, here's genetics when it goes right, and here's genetics when it goes wrong, and what you end up with. And so one of the biggies that is really people who live, well into old age even, that we run into a lot, which is a non-disjunction error during meiosis, is trisomy 21, or Down syndrome. There is no S on Downs. That just drives me nuts. I don't know why, but it just really does. It's Down syndrome. And anyway, so there is the karyotype, and at number 21, the karyotypers, I've not had to number them. There really is a certain set that's called 21 based on length and size and morphology. Is there are three of them. So one of the gametes came in with two. Should have come in with one. One came in with two, so you end up with three at chromosome 21. So there is the mental retardation is really kind of one of our primary things. And then there are all these physical sort of aspects that are common. And heart is one of them. Heart issues is one of them. Macroglossia or large tongue. There are a lot of times there's a lot of lining in the hands. Shorter lifespan is interesting because what I know from this population is not just shorter lifespan because of cardiac trouble, but people with sort of disabilities generally have a little more immunocompromised life, and that shortens their lifespan. Dementia. Cancers like leukemia, often sexually underdeveloped and sterile. And I put some degree of mental retardation can be there. There are so many ways to call mental retardation. I have a brother who has mental retardation. And so that doesn't bother me for that as a diagnosis. That is his state of Oklahoma diagnosis, is mental retardation that doesn't bother. In effect, intellectual deficiency is now the kind of the name for it. I feel like I may have mentioned this before, but I think that sort of fails to tell the whole story. Developmental delays is another one of them, which would also make you think they're going to catch up at some point. There's just no great way to call it. So anyway, because people have used the R word so rampantly, like the N word or a lot of words, and now we're kind of going, don't say retarded. Don't say retard. Don't do it. It's hurtful. It's gross. I feel like that. It causes me great shame personally as someone who has a brother with retardation. I mean, I feel great shame if you say retard. I feel ashamed because I don't know what to do. I don't know how to stand up and what to say. I've gone through a lot of places of that. But anyway, so in an effort to recognize that, retardation has been kind of removed as a diagnosis. But still, my brother has profound mental retardation, and that's his diagnosis. Anyway, just to bring that up, I heard it in rehab. I heard people say, oh, that's so retarded. And we would have brain injury people there. So anyway, and it's not, I don't think anyone really means to be hateful, but, well, what do you mean if you say retarded? Do you mean stupid? Because that's not the same thing. So, I think there's a lot of ways to come at that. But anyway, that's been one of my personal crusades is just to go, that's a hurtful word. And, how you can use it. I don't know why you'd want to. That's kind of one of those things. Another non-disjunction chromosome disorder is Patel syndrome, trisomy at 13. One in 5,000 live births are not super uncommon, and children rarely live but a few months. Serious defects. Edwards syndrome is trisomy 18. Now, you know, that doesn't mean you don't have some kids going further into their lifespan, but typically not not as far, and that is pretty uncommon, and almost every organ system can affect it. So what I want you to see is that errors during meiosis may result in a gamete that is not viable, but it may result in a viable gamete, but not necessarily a viable birth, or you may get a viable birth, but not a longevity of life. And so that you have, just depending on which chromosome is extra or missing, I guess. Missing chromosomes are pretty deleterious. You can have an extra, but it's going to affect the system at most levels. Klinefelter syndrome is very interesting to me. XXY, so in this case you have trisomy at the sex chromosome, XY, happens now in about 1 in 500 to 1 in 1,000 male births. And I think this is just a really interesting area of some things that we're beginning to see a lot of discussion about, and equality among people, you know, and how we used to sort of marginalize peoples. And I wonder that gender is not as set as we have always, we tend to want to think that it is. And so Klinefelter is, maybe it's the source of some of that. Male sex organs are typically small, the patient is sterile, there can be a little bit more of a feminized habitus, body shape and such, breast enlargement, other feminine body characteristics. You may remember seeing Klinefelter pictures where maybe it's a man who has a little bit more wider hips kind of thing, has a little bit more of a feminized body shape and so forth. Intelligence is not affected, so I think it's really interesting. And you know, I have never liked the whole gender reveal thing. I mean, I didn't find out my baby's gender just because I'm such a freak about it's a biological response, you know, pregnancy. And so I really didn't want to bond with my baby while I was pregnant until the pregnancy stuck, you know, because I know so much can happen in the first 3 months. I was very clinical about it. And also I thought, gosh, I would hate to hear the gender and be like disappointed and have that in me and then be feeling like that. You know what I mean? Like, it just, that was just me. I was really trying to think about how can I be a responsible carrier of this human. And and then you see it and you go, oh my God, you're so pretty. You know, it's the weirdest thing. All of a sudden you're not a responsible host. You know, you are, you have been invaded by an alien. And that's really the fact. But anyway, I just think these gender bills, now you kind of go, I wanted that moment of them going, it's a girl. Like, oh my God, you've been kicking the shit out of me. That's the first thing I said to my daughter. Aw, that's sweet. You've been kicking the shit out of me. Don't worry. I have taken very good care of her since. She is a princess. But I think it's interesting, you think, the alley with the ginger reveal, and I think it's so cute, and I would love to be part of that, and cut the cake, and it's pink, and whatever. But you kind of go, haven't you placed a lot of expectation about that person already? What if they're not just super feminine? What if they're not princess? What if they aren't even real female? I mean, it's just an interesting thought. And you do your pregnancy your way. You have pink wounds. I don't care. Enjoy it. That's what you should do with a pregnancy, is enjoy it. But anyway, I think it's just also interesting. And Klinefelter syndrome is, there's probably a lot of and stuff out there I haven't looked up yet. Just about this. It's a fluid gender, I guess is what I'm going to say. Monosomy X, if you don't get the Y there, Turner syndrome, not that uncommon, and this is going to happen for females, and they have an X, an XO, and O just means a zero for the Y, it's not there. Genetically female, but maybe not sexually mature, they're sterile, short stature, 98% die before birth, and so they're inconsistent with life too. So that's just kind of a whole interesting gender thing, and I think that it's something to think about. Spend some time thinking about, because you know you're just encountering more and more sort of intergender peoples. They have always been out there, but now it's thus cloaked, which is, I think, great. Cri du chat, cry of the cat. It's a deletion of a small portion of chromosome 5, experimental retardation, a cat-like cry, and very inconsistent with long life. Fragile X, most common form of mental retardation. This is an X chromosome that has a kind of a hanging tip. The X is fragile. It doesn't really function right. How that plays into sort of mental retardation is interesting. We see fragile X in 1 in 1,300 males, 1 in 2,500 females, and typically have some form of mental retardation. So that's really interesting. My brother has not been diagnosed with fragile X, but this is here when he was better than he is now. And I used to cut my hair really short, but now I looked, my husband and I were morphing into the same human being. Because I buy all his clothes, I buy all my clothes. We'd come around the corner in a blue shirt and some khaki shorts with the same haircut, and I was just like, I gotta feminize. And so, I mean, yeah, I didn't have to, but for me, I felt that I needed to distinguish myself from my husband. Also, if it weren't obvious anyway. But we had looked at an RV, and we looked just alike, and I was just like, I'm growing my hair out. Anyway. But that's my brother, Carrie. He's 58 years old, quite disabled. He has been diagnosed as autistic. He's a non-communicator, and he had a brain injury about 2 years ago, two years ago, when someone gave him the wrong medication and he had to be coded. So, you know, it's just so unfortunate, so unlucky. He's so debilitated, truly. But anyway, I think it's interesting he may have fragile X, although no one's, we haven't done a karyotype. So anyway, I just would like for you to, that's just my personal story, but I just think you're going to walk into a lot of situations where you hear the R word and, you know, champion those that can't champion themselves. If you feel so inclined, I encourage you to do that. I heard someone say, this is my favorite way someone handled it. Somebody was going, yeah, what a retard. It was in one of my classes during lab. And I, of course, I like a, you know, what do I do? What do I say? And this young woman just said, hey, chief, you're pretty comfortable with that word. That was a great response, you know, and it just, it didn't put him in any way, it didn't insult him, it just like, hey, have you noticed you're comfortable with that word, you know, maybe you thought about it, thought that was good. Anyway, nucleic acid, so it's genetics, we have to talk about DNA a whole bunch. You know a lot about DNA, you started hearing about it in, gosh, maybe now, it's like third grade or something. The sugar is deoxyribose, a 5-carbon sugar. The bases are nitrogen-containing compounds that come in one of four flavors, adenine, thymine, cytosine, guanine. And we typically then just refer to the base with the first letter, A, T, C, G. The structure of an individual, the nucleotide is the sugar nitrogenous base. And then the structure is that nitrogenous bases are adhered together at their sugar. There's a phosphate attached to that sugar, and they join together there, forming a sugar phosphate backbone with these nitrogenous bases sticking out. We know that DNA will form two strands, and that those nitrogenous bases will form an adherence to each other through hydrogen bonding. So it's not covalent. Covalent's really strong and hard to pull apart. Hydrogen is softer, easier to pull apart. And so bases will adhere to one another in a complementary fashion. A's with T's, C's with G's. These are things you do know. And you remember that 5' and 3'? People are always real, I thought, overly geeked up about 5' and 3'. I don't, it's, you know, you just, those carbons are numbered. And so the way nucleotides attach to each other from, you know, the 3', the 5', I mean, you know, it's not a big deal. They just stuck together and form a backbone. I never bothered that never bothered me too much. But it just means that there's a direction of being read. You can read from one direction to the other, and how its use is more important than where it all ties together. Has anyone sequenced DNA? You've done you've done gels and done some, like, you know, where you just clip up DNA into chunks. And so you know a lot about DNA already. And so I think it's so lovely, it's so beautiful. I have such affection for this thing, this molecule, that just so simplistically makes all the diversity of life come from those four bases. It couldn't be more simple, really. And yet, you know, it's the most complex. Life is the most complex thing. I mean, till the last dying breath. My only hope is that in the afterlife, all the answers are revealed. That'd be such a gas. I mean, honestly, I hope that happens, because I have so many questions for Jesus. I mean, I have so many questions. My friend says, I'm going to talk to Jesus about that. But, you know, I have so many questions. Don't you just hope you get to figure out what it is? This is so complex. And yet, ACTG is the story. I just, the chills. It's so beautiful physically. This double-stranded helix, you know that about the shape of DNA, and that it can twist and twist. And something, what's true about a helix is as it twists, it gnarls down on itself, and that you can twist it around proteins and create all of this organization. So lovely. So here is the complementary base pairing A's with T's and C's with G's. And we know that those strands aren't just lined up in a parallel way. They are anti-parallel. Oh, did you hear my range of motion limitation? They're arranged anti-parallel, so you have this sort of sense strand, not a sense strand, but that's so important. But both strands code, both strands have information. That strands are complementary to each other. They're not exact. Where an A is, there's a T on the other side, so complementary. And that's just so fascinating that you can create a lot of information in that sense space. RNA, the thing that gets the assist, the sugar is ribose. So it's a 5-carbon sugar. The bases are similar. There are A's, U's, C's, and G's. And those nitrogenous bases will complementary base pair with the analogous base for DNA. RNA is cool because RNA will line up with DNA, and RNA can line up with RNA. And that's why it's so incredibly functional, why there are so many forms of RNA. The structure of RNA is generally, most RNAs are single-stranded. It's not forming this double-stranded helix. There are times, depending on the RNA, that it will bend back upon itself and complementary base pair with itself to form a conformation or shape, but for the most part it's existing in a different way than double-stranded DNA. A's bind to T's, U's with A's, C's with T's. So it's that uracil base that's different among the bases. So RNA is nucleotides of ribonucleic acid that will also form a backbone between sugars and phosphates with their nitrogenous bases out in space to act as business portion of those that can plug into either DNA or other RNAs. The three major flavors of RNA, functionally in terms of making proteins, messenger RNA was made during transcription. It's a single-stranded complementary copy of the gene. RRNA is RNA that gets transcribed, exits the nucleus, and hooks up with ribosomal proteins to form two ribosomal subunits. Ribosomal subunits come together during the act of translation and act as the seat for establishing reading frame during translation and helping to grow the amino acid chain along with transfer RNAs. Transfer RNAs are lovely, so ergonomic. What's more ergonomic than a transfer RNA? I don't know. Everything else in the cell, I guess. But transfer RNAs are translators. They speak two languages. Messenger RNA, complementary base language, through anticodons. and they speak amino acid language. And so they read nucleic acid language, and they bring in the appropriate amino acid. So lovely. They know both languages. And so transfer RNAs are transferring amino acids into the translational process so that a protein can be made, protein amino acid chain. Those are the three functional RNAs. They're important. And here's more of a little picture that summarizes that. And so just know that all of the RNAs are produced from transcription. It's just they function differently post-transcriptionally. Nucleic acids. Now, how does DNA and RNA work? And it's this, that when you copy the entire genome, you make a replica of that genome. I think these are so beautifully named. I like that because, you know, when the memory fails, you go with what does the word mean, and isn't it nice when it means what it is? Replication is to make an exact copy of all the DNA, so to copy the genome. The only reason you would want to do that, because it's so labor-intensive and expensive, is for the purpose of reproduction. So replication happens during the cell cycle in readiness for cell division. So a parent cell has two copies of the DNA, one for each daughter cell. It is semi-conservative. Do you remember that word? You remember that word? Did I just say that like that? I did. You remember? it just means that there are two strands of DNA, and this strand gets replicated, and this strand gets replicated. So it's semi-conservative, meaning that each daughter DNA replica is retaining one parental strand. And so rather than keeping one parental strand and having one completely replicated strand, you're going to divvying that up. DNA polymerase is the enzyme. Now, lots of enzymes function in all this, of course. But the enzyme that is important in getting replication done is DNA polymerase. One is just kind of big, and it's going to help separate strands and keep them separated. It will help the pacing and moving along and helping to connect that nascent, growing incoming nucleotide chain. And it can back up and proofread a little bit, which is very cool. And DNA polymerase. It is an enzyme that polymerizes many DNA nucleotides to form DNA. That's another word that tells you what it is. Love that. And so here's a real electron micrograph of the process. It's just so cute to me. And then, you know, you have a lot of enzymes that are there helping to relieve the tension. Because when you open up part of that, you're causing tension in that helix on other ends. So there's all of these enzymes that are kind of cutting and putting back together. And think about the danger in that. Every time you open and reattach DNA, there's a lot that can be lost. In fact, there's an acceptable amount of built-in error for that. And so that maybe that has partly why the genome is large, you know, it has all this sort of non-coding DNA to help errors not be deleterious. But that's dangerous business, and so you really, it's expensive, and you don't want to do it all the time, so just for the purpose of reproduction. What is that? Okay, and another process that involves DNA. So there are two big processes that involve DNA. Replication, the other is transcription, or to transcribe. It's not replicating, it's not copying, because when nucleotides interact with each other, there's complementary base pairing. So you're not taking an A and matching it with an A, you're taking an A and matching it with this complementary base of T. So we say that that is, you're transcribing the DNA template into an RNA transcript. It's not an exact copy, it's a complementary copy. The enzyme that really gets the credit for accomplishing this is called RNA polymerase. It's an enzyme which polymerizes or sticks together many RNA nucleotides to form a transcript. Again, a great name. And so a gene will be complementary copied in its entirety from its promoter to its end, and that's forming an RNA transcript. Now that mRNA or messenger RNA transcript is not done. It's nipped and tucked and tailored to remove introns, and so it gets smaller. And all of that processing of the RNA to form the final transcript occurs in the nucleus for the most part. And so that's very fascinating and interesting. And then the messenger RNA transcript can go out, and now DNA is done. Those are the two things that DNA do. Replication, which is once in a lifetime, and transcription, which is constant at the chromatin level. Transcription, oh, here's a little picture that would just kind of show you those, that splicing of introns and the revelation of a final mRNA transcript, which would exit via those big old nuclear pores. Translation is another process that happens, but it's not involving the DNA at all. Transcription and translation together are known as protein synthesis. Which you know well to be true. And during translation, you're using transfer RNA and ribosomal RNA, and you're making a protein, which is going to be a bunch of amino acids. And you know that. I just like to make sure we're all playing into the same ones. Translation, the messenger RNA transcript exits the nucleus after it's been transcribed and processed. It will immediately meet up with ribosomes, subunit large, subunit small, and that just kind of establishes the reading frame. In fact, ribosomes will line up against along that whole thing, so you have an amplification process. During transcription, probably several transcripts get made, but for every transcript, several proteins will get made, so it's a great way to amplify that process, because for every ribosome ratcheting across that thing, it will be a nascent, new and growing protein, and you just line up, and as long as that thing is lined up with ribosomes, it's protected from destruction, and you can make proteins. And that's a really great way of not having to go make one transcript per protein. We say sort of one gene per protein, but it's many proteins per transcript. So we have an amplification process that goes on during transcription or translation. Ribosomal RNA is part of the ribosomes, and then transfer RNA translates what's written along that messenger RNA transcript in nucleotide, and it's bringing in the appropriate amino acid, and it's reading three bases at once. On the transcript is called a codon, and on the messenger RNA, transfer RNA is an anticodon. That's how those things lock together, and then it's carrying its little amino acid, and it's the function of the ribosome to help create that peptide bond between those two amino acids, and then that transfer RNA can fall away. The ribosome will ratchet to the next spot or codon to be read, and a new transfer RNA comes in. Very energy expensive, much more so than transcription, and so you really want to have a lot of controls for all of this. So we have a lot of ways to actually destroy transcripts so that you're not wasting making proteins. Because every time a transfer RNA gets filled with an amino acid, and every time an amino acid, there's a peptide bond between there. There's just ATPs being used. I mean, just all the time throughout that. Very energy expensive. And so that's one of the things that you're feeding your body for, is to keep this process going on all the time. I think that's so cool. Feed your body Skittles, or feed your body high quality protein. Which one is going to keep this process going? Cute, love translation. Here's the genetic code. Memorize that. Sorry, babe. That was awesome. But you know, you always heard there's redundancy in a code, and that just means for a codon, those are codons that are written there, and not what the transfer RNA is carrying in. And that's not the same as condom, although those are important. You don't know how many times I've seen condom written. And I just encourage you to use condoms. But understand that a codon is on the transcript. And so more than one codon encodes an amino acid, so that's redundant. So you can even have errors and still end up with the same amino acid being filled in. And so this is a route around mistakes. So there are going to be mistakes, and the body's just kind of like, oh, we're ready for it. And so here's just a little picture of the translation process, the genetic codes. As you know, there are about 20 amino acids that you translate from four nucleotide bases to about 20 amino acids, and you end up with 10,000 flavors of proteins in a cell at a time. It's great. That's really nice. An average protein, lots of variation, of course, but it's not uncommon for a protein to have around 1,000 amino acids. It can certainly have more than that. So 1,000 amino acids relates to a 3,000 length transcript, but that was a lot longer gene because there was a lot of processing done there. So that's where you get all them base pairs, all the nucleotides. Okay, take a little break here for a few minutes, and we're going to roll